Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Sweet Spot, a novel by Amy Poeppel. Read by Billie Fulford-Brown, Stephen Graybill, Aden Hakimi, Daniel Henning, Nancy Linari, Carly Robbins, Jackie Sanders, and Erin Ruth Walker.
The sweet spot is where duty and delight converge. Thomas Mann. If you listen, truly listen, to an adversary, you will probably find at least one goal on which you agree. Gloria Steinem.
Prologue. Felicity had walked by the brownstone on Waverley Place dozens of times, without ever noticing it. The homes in this neighborhood were charming, harkening back to bygone horse and buggy days, but this particular house, tired and unadorned, asked to be ignored. The building had reached a certain level of disrepair, wherein it was neither eye candy nor an eyesore. It was simply unremarkable. But the location! Felicity could not imagine how a potter could have landed such prime real estate in Greenwich Village, the only corner of Manhattan, with its rows of townhouses and its famous park, mews and alleys, elms and sycamores, that reminded her of the best parts of London. Looking up to double-check the number next to the peeling red door, she wondered, was the ivy damaging the brick facade? Was the interior equally shabby? If so, would they gut the whole building? Install central air? Would they kick out that dive bar in the basement and move the entrance to the lower level? Or dig deeper to build a garage? As she climbed the worn stairs, her sandal caught on a broken step, and the thin blush-colored strap across her toes snapped. She took the shoe off, cursing under her breath, and rang the bell. She heard children shrieking from inside, and placed a hand over her belly, where her own little offspring, the size, according to her OB, of a turnip, was floating around obliviously, tethered to her insides. When the door opened, a small girl, 5, 9, Felicity wasn't especially familiar with the developmental stages of young people, and a large dog crowded the entry, both of them electrified by her arrival.
Mommy!
The girl yelled into the expanse behind her.
There's a lady!
Lauren came to the door, her hair half falling out of its clip. Come in, she said, trying to restrain the dog from drooling on Felicity's tiered dress.
Bumper, no!
She clipped a leash on him. We rescued him last week. He's 3 already, but you sure wouldn't know it. He's a handful.
I apologize for inviting myself last minute, Felicity said, still standing in the doorway. But I wanted to chat in person.
No, I'm happy you came, she said. We're in mid-move, so forgive the chaos. Felicity was used to people apologizing for the state of their homes, even when those homes were lovely. It wasn't easy, she knew, to welcome a designer of some renown into one's living space. Felicity's TV show, still going strong after 6 seasons, demanded, for the sake of entertainment, that she say insulting things to the homeowner victim guests. But that was not. She had to explain all the time who she was. That was only a persona. She was, in reality, perfectly kind and polite. Besides, Felicity had not come to the brownstone to judge.
Watch your step, Lauren said, as they entered the living room, and Felicity did, maneuvering around unpacked boxes, over stacks of books, and past dizzyingly unattractive 70s wallpaper.
They went through the dining room and into the kitchen, with its avocado green appliances and orange formica countertops, to the back of the house, which had a door opening onto a deck.
I thought we could sit out here, Lauren said, since it's so warm.
The children, there were 3 of them, were planting something in terracotta pots, their hands caked with dirt. The dog put his head in the watering can.
Your sandal, Lauren said,
noticing that Felicity had one bare foot as she stood on the splintered deck. It broke,
Felicity said, with a little lift of her shoulders, the sandal hanging off her pinky. It wasn't tragic, but it was disappointing. She'd bought them last week on Bond Street in Mayfair. Charles, Lauren said to the tallest child, taking the sandal and putting it in his muddy hands. Be a clever boy and see if you can fix this. Lauren took that moment to introduce Felicity to her kids. Charles, Harold, Waverly, and of course Bumper. This is Mommy's new friend, Felicity. Did you say Waverly? Felicity said. Like your street? Leo grew up here, Lauren said, running a hand over the girl's long hair. And we always loved the name. It's beautiful, said Felicity. Leo's mother was Charlie Aston, Lauren said. I don't know if you've heard of her, but this was her house. Really? How remarkable. Felicity had indeed heard of Charlie Aston, a pioneer of the American feminist movement, though she'd never seen one of her plays. We love the neighborhood, Lauren said, but the noise at night takes a little getting used to. I live nearby, closer to the Hudson, said Felicity. It's a smidge less lively. Oh, you're a neighbor, Lauren said happily. I didn't realize. The children were fascinated by the task of repairing a real shoe that was meant for a grown-up's actual foot. I know what to do, the shorter boy said. Surgery, said Waverly. Felicity loved an original name, but she didn't love the idea of these scruffy children messing with her footwear. Before she could object, they took her sandal inside, conspiring about what would work best. A stapler? Duct tape? Glue? A soldering iron? They're between schools right now, Lauren said, as if explaining their availability to take on this job. I'm sorry. We moved boroughs, and it got complicated to transfer schools so close to the end of the academic year, so we're homeschooling. A little alarm went off in Felicity's head. Homeschooling was surely time-consuming. Have you hired a governess or something? A tutor? Lauren laughed. Nope, just me, she said, and indicated the soil on the deck and the seedlings in the pots with pride. She must have seen the look on Felicity's face, because she quickly added, Oh, it's only for a few months. They'll start at Perkins in the fall. She gestured with her arm, offering Felicity a chair. Felicity brushed off the seat before she sat down, putting her Celine bag on her lap to hide her baby bump, and looked out over the barren yard. In spite of the unseasonable warmth, the trees had yet to put out a single leaf. There was opera coming from an open rear window of another brownstone across the way, a house that had been made over top to bottom with a copper pH artichoke lamp hanging dramatically over the dining room table. Everything at Lauren's, on the other hand, from the rotting porch railing to the dog's smelly fur to Lauren's tired overalls, needed freshening. There were few arguments Felicity could come up with for conserving or treasuring the old and worn, and in this case, what she would do is blow out the whole backside of the house, replacing the north-facing wall with a Swiss-made pivoting glass door that would let in the light and create a seamless transition to the outdoors. So, Felicity said, coming to the point of her visit, your samples arrived at our office last week, and they're stunning. My team created an Instagram teaser to test the market, and it got over 30,000 clicks in the first hours. Lauren put her hands to her cheeks. She wore very little makeup. From the moment they'd met a few months before, Felicity had instantly liked something about this woman. Her lack of artifice, maybe. Her edginess was apparent only in the context of her work. She was the type of open, sweet woman Felicity thought she should be friends with. And she likely knew a thing or two about mothering in New York City, a skill Felicity now considered interesting and even useful. Like this school, Perkins, that her kids would go to. Was it too soon to put her fetus on a wait list? I'm not even on Instagram, Lauren said. 30,000 sounds like a lot. It's very promising, said Felicity, and I'm not surprised. There's something about the way you combine the appealing with the abhorrent that speaks to the zeitgeist. People want joy, but they feel evil lurking. Or maybe they want to know beauty can exist in spite of mutating germs. Felicity felt she'd explained enough. She had a sense for what people wanted, and Lauren's pieces were going to sell. I made you something, Lauren said, to express my gratitude for even considering my work. She looked giddy, almost childlike.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.